Okay, so I guess it's time to start. Okay. So last time we have discussed a notion of independence on small subsets of a monster model of an omega stable theory, right? So we have defined this notion of independence, which comes from the non-forking relation. And we have observed that it satisfies a number of properties which make it look alike the algebraic independence in a strongly minimal theory, for example. But this works more generally in any omega stable theory, or even stable theory. Okay. And also we remarked, so I have remarked at the end that any existence of such a relation satisfying that list of axioms that we had, in fact, characterizes stability. And not only it characterizes stability, but also it implies that any relation satisfying all those axioms must be exactly the non-forking relation. Okay, so this is not random. This is a completely canonical object. Any relation of independence satisfying those natural properties must actually come from non-forking that we have defined. So even though that definition might have seemed technical, this shows that in fact this is a canonical relation. Anything you might define satisfying those natural properties is going to be exactly what we have defined. Okay, so we have this notion of independence, and we have discussed canonical parameters of formulas, right? So we saw that working in this structure MEQ, whenever we have a definable set, it's always possible to choose canonical parameters of definition for this set. Okay, and one more thing that we have considered was definability of types. Okay, so stable implies types are definable. Okay. Which one way to think about it is that if I'm given a type over a very large set of parameters, potentially, over the monster model, let's say, this definability of types in a stable theory implies that, in fact, this type can be described by a small amount of data, by a bounded amount of data. So even though in principle to describe my type, I have to tell you for each single formula, for each choice of the parameters in the monster, I have to tell you if this formula is in the type or not, right? But stability, definability of types in stable theories, what it tells us that in fact, in order to completely describe your type, you only need to fix a definition schema for each of the formulas, okay? And this is going to be just the size of your language. So it's a much smaller amount of data, which you can use to describe completely your global type. Okay, so it's this very strong locality principle. And now I would like to combine the notion of canonical parameters for formulas to produce some kind of canonical parameters for types or canonical bases for types. Canonical bases. Okay. First, let's make a definition. A type P over a set of parameters A is called stationary if it has a unique non-forking extension to any larger set of parameters. So to any B which contains A. And I recall the context, so we are working in the monster. Okay, so we fix T, and we fix the monster model, and we have the imaginaries associated with this monster model. Okay, so type is stationary if it has unique non-forking extension to every larger set of parameters. Another way to say it is to say that it has unique non-forking extension to the whole monster model. Okay, so equivalently, exists a unique Q extending P, where Q is a global type, so it's a type over the monster model, and I will refer to types over the monster model as global types. Okay, such that Q doesn't fork, Q is a non-forking extension of P. Why is this equivalent? Well, because we saw that forking satisfies transitivity. So if I take non-forking extension of P to some larger set of parameters B, and then let's say I extend it to an even larger set of parameters, then these are going to be compatible types. And then I can just glue all of them together and obtain one global type. Okay. All right, so a type is stationary if there's only one way to extend it freely or generically to a larger set of parameters. Okay. Now, we already saw that any type over model is stationary. Okay, so we saw, with this new terminology, we saw that if P is a type over model, then P is stationary. Right, that we saw that it is stationary, and we saw that the unique non-forking global extension of P can be obtained precisely using the definition schema that we know exists to define P. Okay, more careful analysis yields the following. Yields the following fact or lemma. So let T be stable. And assume I have some subset of the monster model such that it is algebraically closed in the sense of the MAQ. So A is equal to the ACLQ of A. Okay? So I assume that all algebraic elements over A are already in A. So for example, A can be a model. Because we saw that taking algebraic closure of an element, you can never get out of the model in which your element is contained, right? It's just because there's a formula with a finite set, and finite sets don't grow if you pass to a bigger structure. Okay? So for example, A can be a model. So for example, A is an elementary substructure of M. Okay, then under this assumption, any type P over such a set of parameters A is stationary. Okay? So in fact, this shows exactly what you need. So you need a bit less than a model. It's enough to have an algebraically closed set, but you might have to include all these imaginaries. Okay. We will call the type of an element A or the algebraic closure of a set of parameters capital A, we'll call it the strong type of little a over capital A. Which will be denoted as the strong type of A over A. Okay. So with this definition, of course, you can see immediately that if two elements A and B, let's say, have the same type over a set of parameters, if they have the same strong type over a set of parameters, then they certainly have the same type, because in fact you have even more parameters potentially here. However, the converse is not always true. So sometimes it's true, sometimes not. But for the general development, often we want to look at this more. We want to look at these extra parameters which come from this algebraic closure to be able to achieve stationarity of our type. Okay. In any case, so we will refer to the strong type of A over A. Okay. Now I would like to define the canonical base of a type. So definition. Assume we're given a global type, and assume that it is definable. So this definition makes sense in any theory, but it's particularly useful in the stable case, as we will see. So assume P is a global type, which is definable. So once you fix any L formula, the set of those parameters with which this formula appears in the type is itself a definable set, right, according to our definition. So assume this is a definable global type. Okay. What does it mean definable? So more specifically, it means that it is A definable over some small set of parameters A. So for global type, when I say it's definable, I mean it's definable over a small set of parameters. Small means smaller than the cardinality, than the saturation of the monster. Okay. Now we define the canonical base of this type. Of P, which will be denoted as CB of P, to be the following set of elements. So we take the codes. Okay, so first of all, I look at the codes of all of the defining schemas for the formulas in this type. So phi varies over all formulas. And then I take the definable closure of this set. Okay, so this is our definition. So what are we trying to define here? So intuitively, I'm trying to define the smallest definably closed set of parameters over which my global type can be defined. Okay, so we know it's definable over some set, but potentially the set A involves a lot of unnecessary parameters, and possibly there is another set A prime over which this type is definable as well, and it may happen that this A and this A prime are disjoint. Okay, so what we are trying to find here is some kind of canonical base over which this type can be defined. And to remember that if you look at a formula or a definable set, we know how to choose a canonical parameter of definition for this set, right? We had this definition of canonical parameter for a formula. So now, since I know my type is definable, I know that for every formula, the set of parameters with which this formula occurs in my type can be defined by this formula here in the brackets, right? So then I just look at this formula, and I take the canonical parameter to define this formula, okay, which corresponds to this angled brackets. So this gives me a set over which certainly I can define my type, but now also this is canonical up to, again, up to interdefinability. Okay? So this is the definition. So the point is that okay, so the point is that that for any automorphism, so let me, okay, for any automorphism sigma of the monster, sigma fixes the canonical parameter of the corresponding defining formula, dp phi of y, if and only if it permutes the set of those parameters with which this formula appears in the type. Okay, so sigma permutes the set of all those b in the monster such that phi of xb is in my type P. Okay? This is immediate from the choice of this formula dp of phi. So this is a formula which defines those parameters with which, so it defines, so this formula simply defines this set. Okay? And then by the properties of the canonical parameters that we have discussed, fixing the canonical parameter by an automorphism corresponds to the set being preserved set-wise under the action of this automorphism. Okay? So using this now, and using our lemma about Galois theoretic characterization of definability over sets of parameters, we have the following statement. So we have the following remark. Given a global type, and a small set. Then the type P is A invariant if and only if the canonical base of this type is contained in the definable closure of this small set of parameters A. Okay, so remember we had the lemma for canonical parameters, which told us that given a definable set, it can be defined over a specific set of parameters A, if and only if the canonical parameter of the set belongs to the definable closure of that set of parameters. Right? So now we generalize these two types from definable sets. So I want to make this decision simultaneously for all formulas that may appear in my type. And it's possible because, first of all, I have definability in stable theories. So there is already this locality that for each formula, I can define those parameters with which it appears in the type. And then I just take the canonical parameter of that set. And combining these two things, we get that invariance of P over some small set of parameters A is characterized by this canonical collection of parameters to be contained in the definable closure of this set. Okay? In particular, we get the canonicity of this set. So the canonical base of P is the smallest definably closed set in MAQ over which P is invariant. Okay? So remember that even for canonical parameters of formulas, we always argued up to interdefinability. So you cannot go any further. So there is some loss of precision. But as long as we argue up to interdefinability, this is a completely canonical thing. Determined by the type itself, not by anything else. Okay? And now we can characterize we can characterize forking in terms of these canonical parameters. So basically the idea is that you remember our idea of a non-forking extension of a type was that when you have these new parameters, there are no new restrictions imposed on your type. So all the data you need to know to identify your type is already given over the small set. Okay? And this is a strengthening of that idea, which tells us that the amount of data you need to describe your type is exactly the stuff that is contained in the canonical base. And hence, we can describe forking in terms of where the canonical base sits. So namely, we have the following lemma. So let T be stable, and P a global type. Okay. Then P doesn't fork over a set of parameters A if and only if the canonical base of P is contained in the algebraic closure of this set. Okay, this is one. Two, if P doesn't fork over A, and the restriction of P to this set of parameters A is stationary. So P is the unique non-forking extension of its restriction to the set of parameters A. Then this is equivalent to the canonical base of P being contained in the definable closure of A. Okay? So the difference you see here is algebraic, here is definable. And the point is that being contained in the algebraic closure, there is still some bounded amount of freedom remaining, namely the automorphism group of the monster, which fixes A pointwise. It always permutes the algebraic closure, but it's possible that it doesn't fix it. So it's possible that there is a non-trivial orbit. This is exactly what shows that in principle there can be many non-forking extensions of a fixed type P over A, but only boundedly many, because algebraic closure of the set is actually bounded. Okay? But if there's only one extension, then this bounded amount of freedom under the action of the automorphism disappears, and DCL are points which are fixed pointwise by any automorphism fixing A, right? So this way, this this bounded amount of freedom disappears, and we have stationarity. Okay. So we have stationarity. So this is the definition of canonical basis for global types. Similarly, we can define canonical basis of a stationary type in an obvious manner, because stationary type has just unique global non-forking extension. Then let's take the canonical basis of that extension and associate it with the type we started with. Okay? So assume that A is a small subset. And let P be a type over A, which is stationary. Okay, so there's only one way to choose a generic extension of P to a global type. Then we will define the canonical base of P to be the canonical base of this global non-forking extension. So we know there is only one. We have already seen how to define canonical base of a global type. Then we can associate a canonical base to this small stationary type. Okay. And finally about canonical bases. So we can characterize forking in stable theories entirely in terms of the canonical bases. So this is some kind of information theoretic view of forking, of forking calculus. So we have that under the stability assumption, of course, we have the first of all, we have that the following are equivalent. So A, we have that the tuple A is independent from a set B over a set of parameters A. So remember, this means the type of A, little a, over capital AB doesn't fork over the set A. Okay, this is A. B, the canonical base of A over B is contained in the algebraic closure of A. And C, the canonical base of A over A is equal to the canonical base of A over B. Okay. So again, all of this is just a different way to express that the extension of the type of little a over capital A to the set of parameters including B doesn't add any new information. Everything we needed was already contained in the type of A over capital A or the smaller set. Okay. So even though it may seem a little bit esoteric at first, this notion of canonical parameters and canonical bases is very useful because it really allows you to it allows you to ignore a lot of non-canonicity that may be going on around. Yes, question. Right, so maybe I'll actually give some exercises illustrating this. So So typically you see this EQ business as a theoretical construction in general. So it helps us to work in general. Often you don't actually need it. And for example, if you're familiar with some naive algebraic geometry, often if you are given a variety, right, so a set of solutions of some polynomial, often you want to find the smallest field over which you can already define this variety. And then the field of definition of your variety is exactly the canonical base in this setting. So, but one can calculate such things explicitly in different examples. I'll put some exercises in the notes about it. Okay. So the point is that we have this characterization of forking via just containment of this data of the canonical bases. Okay. So this ends the discussion of general forking. For now, so as you can see, we had some ideas, but so far there was not so much geometry going on. So this was a completely general theory. It can be developed in stable theories. In fact, one can make sense of this even in larger settings, for example, for what is called simple theories. There, canonical bases are no longer imaginaries. One must work with a more general notion of hyperimaginaries. So if imaginary is, let's say, a quotient of a definable set by a definable equivalence relation, then hyperimaginary would be a quotient of a type-definable set by a type-definable equivalence relation. Okay, and then one can actually go further. So there are ultra-imaginaries and things like this. Yes?
CV of strong type of A
Right. I guess I haven't written it. Sorry. So CB, where we use the notation, the CB of A over B is the canonical base of the type of A over, of the strong, of the type, canonical base of the type of A over ACLQ of B. Right, so the strong type. Okay. Okay, so this gives us a characterization of forking, which is more hands-on. Well, it's still somewhat abstract, but we will see it will get a bit more concrete. Okay. So now I would like to return to the setting of strongly minimal theories and see what's going on there. Strongly minimal theories, or pregeometries, in fact, we'll be talking about pregeometries, really. So a closer look. Okay. So first of all, to motivate this study, we saw that given an uncountably categorical theory, remember that given an uncountably categorical theory, every model of T is in fact a prime model over a strongly minimal set, right? It's prime over a strongly minimal set. Okay, so in some sense, it's even more than just prime. One can obtain more careful analysis. We don't have time to talk about this. It's really a vibration, a very particularly simple vibration. But in general, we have that you have a strongly minimal core, and then the rest can be built out on top of this strongly minimal core somehow, right? This is what we have proved in the course of Morley's categoricity theorem. Okay, so certainly it indicates that it's very important to understand what strongly minimal sets look like. And again, I recall this motivating question of understanding totally categorical theories. Okay, so this gives us a characterization of uncountably categorical theories. Now, what more can you get if you have an additional assumption of omega categoricity? And turns out that assumption of omega categoricity, it's a syntactic assumption in a sense, but it will tell you a lot about how the pregeometry on the strongly minimal set looks like. Okay? But to be able to talk about these pregeometries, we need some terminology and some overview of pregeometries in general. What can they look like? Okay? So for this, let's discuss pregeometries again. So pregeometries revised. Okay? Let me make some remarks. So I recall that the way we have defined a pregeometry, we define it as a set X with a given closure operator, right? So remember, we have a closure operator, which is a map from subsets of X to subsets of X, such that if you give me a set, I give you the closure of this set, which is some other subset of X, right? So first of all, equivalently, a pregeometry can be described simply by fixing the collection of closed sets. So there are various equivalent descriptions. The one which is indicative for the geometric intuition is the one in terms of the collection of closed sets. Okay, so equivalently, a pregeometry is a set X. So okay, let's say this is a remark. So given a pregeometry, equivalently it is a set X with a collection of subsets. Of subsets C, subsets of 2 to the X. Sorry, so C is a collection of subsets of X, which we will call closed sets. Okay, called closed sets. Satisfying the following. So we want to several natural properties one would expect from a closed set. So first of all, C is closed under intersection. Okay, arbitrary intersections. So given any B, a subcollection of closed sets, I can take the intersection of all of the sets in B, and this is still going to be an element of C. Okay? So any intersection of closed sets is a closed set. We have the exchange principle. So remember, for the closure operator, we had an exchange principle, right? The symmetry of the closure operator. So here we also have an analogous statement in terms of closed sets, which corresponds to the existence of immediate closed extensions. So if I'm given a set C, maybe I shouldn't use the same letters. So if I'm given E in C, and if I'm given an element A, which is not in E, then there is an immediate closed set E prime containing E, so it extends the set E, which contains our new element. So it contains A. Now, what does it mean to be an immediate extension or immediate? Let me call it immediate extension. So there is an immediate extension E prime of E, which contains A. So immediate means there is no smaller set with the same property in between E and E prime. Okay, so IE exists E prime, a closed set, such that E prime contains both the set E we started with and the new element. And there is no other set, E double prime, closed, which is in between. Okay? So with E strictly contained in E double prime, strictly contained in E prime. So given an element, I can increase my closed set a little bit, making sure that I can do it in a minimal way. So there's nothing in between. Okay? This is, and finally, finite character. If I'm given a collection of closed sets, B subset of C, we define the wedge union of the sets in B as the union over all. This is not the definition. So this is the condition, and I say in a second what wedge B means, or VB. Sorry. I should probably use lattice theoretic notational terminology already. So this is the least upper bound for B. So we claim that this is equal to the union over all finite subsets B0 of B. Okay. And I take the least upper bound of B0. Okay. Where this least upper bound is defined naturally. Okay, so the least upper bound for a set of closed sets B is the intersection over all closed sets E in C, such that the union of everybody in B is a subset of E. Okay, so it's the smallest closed set containing everybody in B, so containing all D in B. Okay? Right, yeah. Right, right. So, right. Yeah. No, so we'll see that the least upper bound often is larger than the union of two sets. Right. This tends to happen a lot. Yes. You should think about typically topologies which arise in the strongly minimal setting. They are known. what's the word? Right. Right. Yeah. Yeah, so it's typically not the case, yeah. So you should think about closed sets as very small subsets of the space. It's more like, you know, like the algebraic geometry setting, so it's more like Zariski geometry. But we'll see in a minute what examples of this. Okay, so this, so far, we just wrote a bunch of properties, right? So we're given a collection of sets which we want to think about as the closed sets relatively to some closure operator. So we wrote down some natural properties that it should satisfy. The point is that it's equivalent to our definition with the closure operator. Okay. So, okay. First of all, we can set. Did I put any numbers there? No. Okay. This was one. So remark one. Now two. If I set the greatest lower bound of B to be the intersection over all sets in B, and I will write A is less or equal than B whenever A is contained in B, then this collection of closed sets forms a lattice. And in fact, a complete lattice. Okay. So if you're familiar with this terminology, this can be instructive. Otherwise, it doesn't matter. Okay. Now the point is that we can move between such a closure operator and such a collection of closed sets in a rather straightforward manner. So three, if I'm given a closure operator on X, we can define the collection C of subsets of X to simply be the closed sets relatively to this operator. Right? So we can define C to be the collection of the closures of A, where A varies over all subsets of X. Right? So remember that for each subset of X, we have its closure according to the operator. So let me just look at the image of the operator. Okay, this gives me a collection of closed sets. Conversely, if I'm given a collection of closed sets, so I'm given C, a subset of X, a subset of 2 to the X, sorry, of closed sets, we can define a closure operator. So we can define a closure operator CL of A by taking the intersection over all closed sets which contain A. So it's intersection over all, let's say, D in C, such that A is a subset of D. And it's exercise to verify that if you have this list of axioms for the collection of closed sets, then we can, it's equivalent to the axioms of a pergeometry that we have stated before, okay? So equivalence exercise. Okay, now recall, so I believe we have already defined this when we were talking about pergeometries for the first time, but let me just recall that if I'm given two sets A and B, subsets of X, then we can define the dimension of A over B to be the cardinality of a basis for A over B that is a subset A prime of A of minimal size such that the closure of A prime together with B is equal to the closure of AB. Okay? So the same intuition as for the basis of a vector space. Now, let's see. Okay, equivalently, the dimension can be described as the length of a chain which takes us from the closure of B to the closure of AB. Okay, so equivalently, the dimension of AB, A over B, sorry, is the length D of any chain of immediate extensions of closed sets such that the first of them is equal to the closure of B. So we take the closure of B to be the first set, C0. And then we have a sequence of immediate extensions, C1, etc., up to CD, where CD is equal to the closure of AB. Okay? So if, another way to think about it is that, let's say in my vector space, if I'm given, so I start with a set B and I add new algebraically independent elements one by one, until I arrive to the set AB, right? To the closure of the set AB. Okay. So this dual picture, we will use it freely, this passage from the closure operator to the collection of the closed sets corresponding to it. Finally, okay, we were using the word pregeometry. So what does this pre stand for? And why? Okay, so the point is that for every pergeometry, we have a natural associated geometry. Let me state it in the remark as a remark or okay, remark or definition. I guess definition is better. Sorry. Okay. So one, we can talk about the localization of a pergeometry. So the localization of X at a set A is given by the set XA, assume I'm given a pergeometry, on a set X with a closure operator, okay? Now I want to define the localization of this pregeometry at a certain set A, which is a subset of X. So this is going to be a new pregeometry, which I define, so the underlying set is the same, doesn't change, but the closure operator is now different. So the closure operator, relatively to this set A, is defined by taking the closure of AB. So for any B, we take the closure together with A. Okay? Equivalently, I want to look at the collection, so the collection equivalently from the point of view of the collection of closed sets, I only want to look at those closed sets which contain the set A. Okay? So equivalently, the closed sets of XA are the closed sets of X. Which contain A. Containing A. Okay. Also, the question that task, I'm sorry, I have confused myself, so I was actually thinking about the dual point of view. Here everything is going, sorry, here the whole space is certainly going to be closed. So there's a dual geometric picture here, which we will discuss soon. And I had that in mind instead. So let me give you some examples, as you can see, and maybe then we can understand what you thought was the problem. Yes, question.
So then the exchange
property follows automatically. Where? Oh, you mean for in this new definition? So I'm not sure I understand. Maybe I didn't define things correctly. So how? Why do you think the exchange follows?
So take a closed set E, yes. Point A. Well, the whole space certainly contains E and A.
Sure.
So then take the intersection of all closed sets containing both E and A. And that's going to be a closed set by the intersection property. And it's also going to be the smallest set containing both E and A.
I see. No, this certainly shouldn't be happening. So maybe I miss. Maybe I didn't define it properly. So okay, let me repeat it and we see. So maybe I miswrote it. I think it cannot be too wrong. Let's see. Okay, so again, we had this property for the closed sets, right? So I claimed that the exchange of the closure operator should correspond to the following condition. Assume I'm given a set C contained in my collection of closed sets. And I'm given an element A, which is not in this set. Okay, so I have a closed set C. I have an element A which is not in it. Okay, then what I want to find, a closed set C prime in my collection, such that I have C prime containing. Okay, so I have C prime. Containing A and C. It contains both C and A. And there is no set C double prime closed, which is strictly in between. So we have C strictly between, strictly smaller than C prime, double prime, sorry, strictly smaller than C prime. Oh, right, yes. Right, sorry, yes. I mean, of course, sorry, I meant among the sets containing K, you can find the minimal one. So let's see. So with the set such that, okay, so there's no C prime here, such that it contains. Oh, did I say it? Sorry.
Right.
Yes. Right. Right. Okay, I confused myself a bit now. So is this good or not good?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, please somebody check. So during the exercise section, check that this indeed corresponds to the exchange. It should mean the obvious thing. I mean, there's nothing. If I wrote something, I'm just blanking out now. But it's just the obvious thing. Okay. So now let's consider some examples again. So we saw already some examples of pre-geometries. Yes. Sorry? There was a 2, I think, no? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, thank you. Yeah, I got off track a bit. Right, okay, so we have defined the notion of localization. Localization of a pre-geometry. Okay? Okay. Two. So let's continue with the definitions. Now we will say that a pre-geometry is actually a geometry which satisfies an additional condition, namely the closure of the empty set is empty. And the closure of any point is just that point. For any A in X. Okay? And there is a general procedure which allows us to obtain a geometry from a pre-geometry. Namely, if X with a closure operator is any pre-geometry, then there's a natural associated geometry. Namely, we can define the set X0 to consist of X with the closure of the empty set removed. Okay? And we consider an equivalence relation. Okay, so consider the relation tilde between on points in X given by A is equivalent to B, if and only if they have the same closure. So the closure of A is equal to the closure of B. Okay. Now, what I claim is that by the exchange property, this is actually an equivalence relation. Okay, so it's an equivalence relation. Then we define the set X hat to consist of the classes, so X0 mod this equivalence relation. And we define a closure operator on X hat. So we define the closure hat on X hat by taking the closure of the set of classes of the elements in A to be the collection of all B mod this equivalence relation, where B is in the closure, in the initial closure of the set A. Okay, then what I claim is that this is a geometry. So X hat together with the closure hat is a geometry. Well, it's not hard to see that we have achieved it. All the properties transfer. So we remove the closure of the empty set and we factored by the closures of the of points. Okay, so now let's start looking at some examples for all of these notions. So we have defined this abstract setup. Let's look at some examples. The first kind of example, so in some of these notions were already mentioned in Stefan's talk, but we will look at them closer. So first of all, we will call a pregeometry trivial or disintegrated. So there are two standard terms in the literature. If the closure of any set A is given simply by the union of the closures of points in A. So separate closures of points in A. Okay. Equivalently, this is the same as saying that the least upper bound of a collection of sets is given simply by their union. Okay, examples of trivial pregeometries. So let's look again at the theory of equality. Assume this is, so we know it's a strongly minimal set. So the operation of algebraic closure is a pregeometry, and it's easy to see that it is trivial. Because all subsets are closed. All subsets are closed. Equivalently, the algebraic closure of any set is equal to itself. Right? So the only algebraic formulas are the trivial ones, the equality. A slightly more interesting example, we have already mentioned it briefly, I think, the if you have a successor relation on the integers, you have a successor function on the integers, sorry. Slightly more generally, you can talk about action of a group, where a group is the part of your language. Okay? So we can view an action of a group G on an infinite set D without any fixed points. Okay, and we think about this group as being incorporated into the language. So we view it as a structure in the language D together with the function symbol G of X for every element of the group, where the function simply corresponds to the action of an element G. Okay, so G of X is equal to G times X. Okay. It's not difficult to verify that this is a strongly minimal structure. With a trivial pregeometry. Namely, the closure of any set B is given simply by the union of the orbits of points in B. Okay, so it's given by all elements of the form G times B, where G is an element of the group, of the acting group, and B is any element in B. So just the union of the orbits. So as Stefan has already alluded, even though We have a group here, but it's not part of the structure. So it's a bounded amount of a group which is completely incorporated into the language. So this is the notion of triviality. Now, exercise. Any pregeometry satisfies the submodular law. Namely, the dimension of the union of two sets, A and B, is at most the dimension of A plus the dimension of B minus the dimension of A intersected with B. Okay, this can be deduced directly from the axioms of a pregeometry. Of course, you can see sometimes, it often happens, that in fact you get inequality. So if you look at the trivial case, let's say, of the theory of an infinite set, then this is just the dimensions correspond simply to the sizes of my sets, and then the inclusion-exclusion formula certainly tells you that this actually holds, that you achieve inequality. There are more complicated, the same happens in vector spaces. If you think about the A and B as being two subspaces in a vector space, then the standard linear algebra will tell you that you have equality here as well. So this motivates the following definition. A pregeometry, X with a closure operator, is modular if for any finite dimensional closed sets, we have that the dimension, that the equality is achieved. So we have that the dimension of the union is equal by the dimension of A, is equal, sorry, to the dimension of A plus the dimension of B minus the dimension of the intersection. In other words, this is the same as requiring that the dimension of A over B is equal to the dimension of A over its intersection with B. Okay. So again, let's say this is exercise. Well, it's really just unwinding the definitions. Let's look at some examples of modular pregeometries. So, okay, the one I already mentioned is, of course, the vector space. So let V be a vector space over a division ring K. Okay, so not necessarily commutative, it doesn't matter. Again, we view it as a structure in the language where scalar multiplication is consists of functions, one function for each scalar in our language. Okay. Then, then if we look at an infinite dimensional vector space, the pregeometry given by the ACL in this structure, we already know, well, first of all, we know it's a pregeometry. So if we are given a model of the corresponding theory of vector spaces, so if I'm given a structure satisfying the axioms of vector spaces over K, somewhat saturated, so enough to require infinite dimensional, okay, then the pregeometry given by the algebraic closure is modular by standard linear, linear algebra. So you all probably saw this before. If I'm given a pair of subspaces and I want to know the dimension of the union, I can calculate it by that formula with the equality. Okay. Note, however, that this is not a geometry. Namely, because the closure of the empty set consists of the zero vector. And for any vector A, which is not equal to the zero vector, if I look at its closure, then the closure just gives me the span of this vector. So it's the line through A and 0. Right? So the algebraic closure of any vector is the line which goes through it. Remember we have this general procedure to turn a pregeometry into a geometry. If we apply it in this case, then the corresponding geometry is obtained by projectivizing . So if you look again at the construction that we have described, we delete 0 in the quotient by the action of scalar multiplication. So lines become points in our new space. And what we obtain the projective space of dimension n minus 1 if n was the dimension of V. Okay, so of dimension equal to the dimension of V minus 1. Okay, so the standard passage from a vector space to its projectivization is exactly the construction of obtaining geometry from a pregeometry that we have described abstractly. Okay. In fact, there's a classical result. Which tells us that some kind of converse also holds. So it's a fact. Any non-disintegrated modular geometry of dimension at least 4 is isomorphic to projective geometry over a division ring. Okay, so this tells that modular geometries only come from this kind of construction. And we'll discuss more how something like this can be proved model theoretically. So it's a classical result, but there's a model theoretic version. There's a definable model theoretic version of this converse. Now, exercise. We described the example of a vector space, but of course all the previous examples, the disintegrated examples, they are all modular as well. So first of all, show that all disintegrated pregeometries are modular. Okay, and two, prove that if I'm given a vector space, then the corresponding pregeometry is not modular. Okay, this is more a remark than an exercise, really, because, of course, you know that the span of two vectors is typically not the union of the spans of each of those vectors separately. So, Okay, so prove that this, if M realizes the axioms of vector spaces, then M together with the algebraic closure is not disintegrated. Okay. So this is a very important example. And and let's consider another example, a couple more. So let's look at the affine space. So we have looked at the vector space. Now let's look at the affine space. So it's example 3, I guess. Again, let V be an infinite dimensional vector space over K. And this time, let's take affine subspaces to be our closed sets. They are affine subspaces. So translates of subspaces. Okay? And let's define the closure of the empty set to be equal to the empty set. Now, this pergeometry can be obtained as the ACL pergeometry for a natural structure. So this is the ACL pergeometry of a strongly minimal structure. In the language given by the following, so we add relations of the form Z is equal to lambda x plus 1 minus lambda y for all scalars lambda in K. Okay. So this is our language. It's not hard to see that the closed sets relative to the algebraic closure in this language, in this structure, will give us precisely the affine subspaces. Okay. Now note that this time the closure of any point A is just the point A. Hence, this is a geometry already. But now we can notice that this is not a modular geometry. Okay. Namely, if you take two parallel lines, if you take two parallel lines within a common plane, then they are going to be dependent, right? Because you can translate one to another. So one is in the definable closure of the other. However, the intersection is trivial. So you can see it fails the definition of local modularity. However, if you localize at zero, so now we only look at those subspaces that go through zero, that contain zero, we get the geometry of the previous example. Okay? So it shows that sometimes you can start with a non-modular geometry, and localizing you get a modular one. Okay? And we will call such pergeometries locally modular. So definition, a pergeometry is locally modular if you can make it modular by localizing at any point you want. Okay, so it's locally modular. If the localization at any element E, which is not in the closure of the empty set, is modular. Okay, then this example of with affine subspaces is locally modular, non-modular. Okay. Okay, so these are some very important natural examples, and there's one more that we will discuss after the break. Okay, thank you. Sorry? Here I localize at any point outside of the closure of the empty set. So, sorry, let me write it more visibly. So you can localize at any A, which is, I can take any point in X, but not in the closure of the empty set. Okay? If all of such are modular, then this is locally modular.